Okay, good morning, everybody, and welcome to our webinar this morning. We are going to be talking about introducing a security feedback loop to your CI pipelines. Today, I have with me Matthew Barker from Twistlock, Dustin Van Buskirk from Codefresh, and Varun Koropati from Steelcase. So let's go ahead and get started with our first presenter, Matthew Barker from Twistlock. He's a senior solutions architect, and I will go ahead and hand it over to Matthew to tell you a little bit more about himself.
Thanks, Taryn. So I've been squarely at the intersection of DevOps and security for the past 8 years, experience in static source code analysis, component scanning for vulnerabilities, and more recently, cloud native security with a focus on Docker containers. Really glad to be here today. And I'll turn it over to our next presenter, Dustin.
Hi, everybody. This is Dustin Van Buskirk. So I'm currently employed at Codefresh as a senior solutions architect. I help with proof of concepts and onboarding of our customers. I previously worked with Steelcase and helped them kind of set up this integration that we'll be showing to you later. And I'll hand it off to Varun Koropati now.
Hi, everyone. This is Varun. I'm a DevOps engineer working for Steelcase. I've been working in Steelcase for around 19 months. And I work with Dustin on implementing the CI/CD process and hooking up the security scanning into the CI/CD. That should be me.
Great. So today we're going to be talking about how to implement security scanning with Codefresh and Twistlock. So first, Twistlock will give a talk on how to improve security. Then Steelcase will give us some of their use cases for security scanning in their CI pipelines. Then we'll go ahead and show you how Codefresh automation works, and Dustin will provide a demo. So first, I'll hand this off to Varun to talk about Steelcase.
Hi, everyone. So Steelcase is a 106-year-old furniture company. We offer a wide range of technology products that fits in with the furniture. So as a part of that products, Workplace Advisor is a main application we work on. It's an analytics platform that gives out usage metrics of the office space. And as a part of that, there's a lot of IoT devices, sensors, and gateways deployed all around. You are all around the office, which has the data of meeting rooms, office spaces, and we have customers on the furniture side of Fortune 500 customers, and our WPA just rolled out, and we are expecting a few more customers to roll in. So privacy is a crucial part because the sensors and collect the data of the meeting rooms and office spaces, we consider privacy a critical part of our application security. And if you go to the next slide. So this is a CI/CD pipeline we want, and we are on our in the process of having. So when a developer commits the code to GitHub, it will send it to Codefresh, and Codefresh will hand it over to Twistlock. And when it comes back, it will then redirect the deployment to Kubernetes or any orchestration service you use. We use Rancher. But if it fails, it's going to go back to GitHub, and that's how your feedback loop works. And Twistlock defenders are deployed in our orchestration that has that will make sure all your security compliances are in place. And that's how this ideal CI/CD and security integrated pipeline is as per Steelcase. The next slide. And I'd like to introduce to Matthew. Matthew.
Yeah, thank you. So the Twistlock platform basically is going to secure your development operations throughout your DevOps lifecycle, from dev to build to test to deployment. We also provide several types of runtime protection, runtime defense, and cloud native firewalling. On the vulnerability management compliance side is the features that kind of fit in today's topic. We pull in vulnerability data from over 30 different sources, and we do over 300 different compliance checks. We get those compliance checks primarily from the Center for Internet Security. What's really important, though, about scanning for compliance and security is that what we've found is a typical application is only about 10% custom code, and 90% would be the components in your app, and then the binaries in a typical Docker file, such as the base OS and the base image. So your developers can do the best job they could to try not to introduce vulnerabilities and security risks in their code. But typically that 90% is the highest risk. And so being able to detect vulnerability and compliance problems as early as possible is critical here. Another shift left approach to security. So with the CodeFresh TwistLock solution, your developers are able to detect those problems early and remediate them long before they reach deployment. And when Dustin does his demo, you're going to see that in action. So why is it important? Why should you care about vulnerability management? Well, as I mentioned first, finding problems early is going to reduce cost by avoiding rework. And being able to eliminate high and critical vulnerabilities early on obviously is going to pay tremendous dividends. Breaches are happening just about every day. The average cost of a breach is over $3 million. So being able to efficiently produce quality code with low risk is going to save money and obviously save the cost of a deadly breach. Equifax breach is a great example of that. The millions of consumer data was released. The costs of that are still going on. So this is definitely a critical topic. So what are some of the advantages that are unique to the TwistLock solution? As I mentioned before, we pull data from over 30 different sources, both open source and commercial feeds. But what we also do is identify the vendor, or what I like to call the authoritative source, for a particular vulnerability. By going to that authoritative source and by having a large breadth of feeds, you get both fewer false positives and false negatives. So you don't miss vulnerabilities because of the breadth of our data. And because we hone in on the best source of data, you eliminate those false positives. Another important feature is being able to set the thresholds for vulnerability and compliance. What I've found through my experience is that most of the vendors out there, particularly the OS vendors, they only fix the medium, high, and critical vulnerabilities, and they focus on the high and critical. So the low and medium vulnerabilities often do not get addressed. So the ability to set a threshold for your tolerance for vulnerability and compliance is a critical part of being able to remediate and be efficient in eliminating that technical debt from vulnerabilities. Another important thing is, I like to say, nobody likes someone that reports a problem and never offers a solution. We at TwistLock, we don't want to be that guy. And so what we do is, whenever we show a vulnerability or compliance issue, there is a clear remediation path. So your developers, we can uncover those problems early and then give your developers the tools they need to remediate those problems quickly. So what are some of the thresholds you can set with the TwistLock platform? So for example, you could say block all high vulnerabilities in a particular library or class of libraries. Another one is to alert if there's medium or high compliance issues. The blocking is pretty cool because the blocking I like to call strong enforcement. If you put blocking in place, it's actually at the build time, it's going to fail the build. And at deployment time, it will stop a particular container with a high vulnerability from actually being able to be launched. Alerts are more like email alerts, Slack, or Splunk alerts that you can set up. So when a when an image container is launched with one of these vulnerabilities or in the build, you would get alerts instead of strong enforcements. We also have another pretty cool feature. It has to do with remediation. Oftentimes for a vulnerability, there is no remediation. The vendor does not have an available fix. Maybe it's a low vulnerability. You can actually tweak our settings, so only reporting vulnerabilities with a known fix. And that way, you know there's a clear remediation path. So our threshold settings are very flexible and kind of to meet your own needs and demands around compliance and vulnerabilities.
All right. So this is the flow that introduces the new integration point for the CodeFresh users to call on the Twistlock service to scan their Docker images after they are built before they are merged into shared branches. To scan your Docker images against Twistlock and return the results to the CI pipeline, parse the results and report the URL back to the image metadata and succeed or fail the build based on the thresholds configured in either CodeFresh or Twistlock. This can be used to prevent known security risks from being introduced to other developers, pushed into a shared Docker registry, or possibly deployed to your upper tier Kubernetes clusters. So by putting this and just introducing it into your workflow, you can block this from going up and out to the internet or to your other developers. So it's, you know, possibly poisoning the well for your Git repository. It's possibly available to your registry for your users to pull. So it just offers a really nice block, like a gate that is required in order to pass anything through into those upper tier environments or to your users. And the feedback loop is pretty much instantaneous. If you fail the build, you'll get a message back to your commit, to your version control system. It's going to show that your build has failed, and you can dig into that build. You can get information out of the build, and also from your Docker image metadata, you can quickly identify one, where's the Twistlock report URL that's stored inside of Twistlock, so I can download that possibly, and also what kind of violations do I have and how many of those violations do I have. Go ahead and go on to the next slide. All right, so we all know, you know, most DevOps engineers and even developers know it's a very time consuming and ongoing process to cobble together all the tooling required for a complete CI/CD experience. Often that burden of maintaining this complex system is put into all the different internal teams. You might even have in some cases a single source, let's say for instance, Brent, that Brent knows everything about Jenkins, and now you've basically singled out all your Jenkins problems over to Brent, and you are now escalating everything to Brent. If Brent's not available, it's a single point of failure. And at CodeFresh, we'll maintain this complex system for you and add the latest features coming to market. For example, continuous delivery to Kubernetes, Helm releases, or ephemeral staging and test environments. You can go on to the next slide. At CodeFresh, we'll maintain this complex system for you and add the latest features coming to market. For example, continuous delivery to Kubernetes clusters, Helm releases, all the things I just said before. And we're 100% committed to Docker and Kubernetes, focused on remaining the CI/CD thought leader in that space. It's something that we're 100% behind. We're not worried about, you know, shipping other artifacts, although we can ship other artifacts. Our primary delivery for features is going to be all Kubernetes centric, all Docker centric. So as you Docker rolls out feature, Kubernetes rolls out features, there's additional features produced by the community like Helm. We're going to adopt those and convert them very quickly into features that are available to you in CodeFresh that you don't have to code on your own. All right, go on to the next slide, please. All right, Varun, this is you.
Okay. Hello again. So I'm here to talk. I'm going to talk about what we have before we introduced Twistlock and CodeFresh, and why we did we automate in this slide. So how much security is secure enough? Well, we have amazing. If your network and node access restriction is enough, or do you think how much you restrict your network access or anything that you do outside of your code is not good security enough, because if your dependency packages might have some bugs, or you need to put your Docker container configuration to align with the Docker security policies. So that's how that's where we had to use this, and it's hard to control what security standards and practices are followed when you have multiple teams that work on different microservices at the same time, and your DevOps team could not catch up with what exactly are those developers using as a security practices. They might have different standards for their side of approach. So it's hard to maintain a unified security standards for all the microservices developed by a couple of teams by 10 or 20 developers. So that's where that's why we had to put in Twistlock integration into the Codefresh and our CI/CD tool. And what did we automate? We have a amazing security team with a specific policies to keep everything in check. And with their requests, it's hard to catch up everything what the policies suggest when you are doing it manually, and it doesn't satisfy the loss of DevOps speed. And also, as part of the policies, we have to scan every image that goes into production or into the master for dev environment, and it's not as faster as you can think if you don't automate it. And it's faster to develop for developers if you have a continued feedback, and in microservice model, faster onboarding of a secure microservice with no security standards is a good approach, rather than selecting a faster approach and you might have forgot few security configurations in your Docker image, or you might have pulled in a new bad dependency package, which is an open source, which is a third dependency of your other dependency package. So it's much easier to scan them and keep the security of it up to date, even for a master branch. And it also involves less security patch releases to production. So you don't have to patch release to production the next day after the production release, and you found out a big bug in the production. That's why we had to automate it. And next slide, please. So what we have right now, we have automated security scan in all the protection branches, and it's not just a master. We also have logical conditions that runs if a developer commits a twistlock scan, it's gonna issue a twistlock scan. If developer issues any twistlock scan in the commit or pull request, it's gonna run that and make sure it is scanned and good to go. If not, it should be blocked. So right now, and also our main condition is all the microservices which we onboard for our application should have security steps configured, and we have a template that can plug into a new microservice and make it running in next 10 or 20 minutes. From start to end. So that's a good thing. And what do we want to have next is the one which Dustin is going to demo next, and is to fail the CI build when the results cross the threshold, and block the merge or PR when the build fails. So we make sure that nothing insecure or nothing that doesn't comply with security policies or Docker configuration policies will not get pushed up to master or even production. So I'll hand over to Dustin for demo.
All right, thanks. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen now. So in this demo, I've went ahead and introduced compliance violation for a Docker image. We, you know, all code our Docker images, and we're trying to follow the best practices, the standards set forth for us as from Docker. And some of those best practices are things like not putting security keys into our repositories or into our Docker images, or not running the container as a root user. In this case, I am running the container as a root user. So I'm actually going to pull down, run the security scan, fail that, and then fix it on the fly. So here I'm gonna go ahead and go to my Codefresh console. I'm gonna add my repository. So I've already forked from the Twist CLI repository that Codefresh has into my own repository. And now I'm gonna add their Docker file here after I've added my repository. And you can see here's the Docker file contents. You'll notice there is no user here. But I'm thinking not everyone understands, you know, what all the standard policies are set in place, you know, to adhere to compliance. So part of this is that as you're adding this, you're also going to be given a feedback loop for best practices with Docker. So here I've added my new pipeline, and now I'm going to go ahead and add some environment variables here to control what happens inside of that integration. So there's a Twistlock configuration that I've added already. You can see here, I've already set the compliance threshold and vulnerability thresholds. And I'm also going to import my Twistlock credentials for my service user. Now that I've imported both of those, I'm actually going to add a couple unit tests in here. And I'm going to add, I want to make sure that after this, I can execute the Twist CLI. And also inside of this image is the CodeFresh CLI. Now I'm going to go ahead and convert this over to a YAML build step. And look at the inline YAML here. This actually makes up my build. So I'm going to add this now as a build step, because what they've given me is the YAML that's used for it. So here's the YAML for the build step, so I can copy that in. All right, great. So I'm copying that over now. And what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to use my build Docker image, which is set right here as the scan image. I'm also going to use that as the image for my scanning service here. This is normally you would put your own image in here. Part of this is that you probably want to, if you're a security-minded team like at Steelcase, they have requirements to build their own images regardless of where they come from. So what they want to do is they want to have the source code repository available. They want to scan that. They want to scan the images, build those images, and push those up to their Docker registry. All right, so I've set everything up here. Let me just do a double check here. And you can see the relationship between the code fresh variables I set above and the environment variables that are coming into this scanning utility here. All right, I'm going to go ahead and save this now. And I'm going to run a build in my master branch. And these builds are supported on any Docker and Docker setup. So you can bring a dedicated node, or you can bring your Kubernetes cluster, either or. And this, all these stages are going to be available to you. What happens is it starts up, it's going to have your volume available to you. It's going to have an integrated Docker registry available to you so that you can quickly cache all your Docker image layers. You can see here, I've already built this before, so I cached a lot of those layers previously. So now as I'm building out my Docker image, it's going to result in an image file. And then I'm going to use that image file to scan the image and also as the image file that I'm scanning against. So here, real quick, running the unit test, everything is confirmed here. So I can, Twistlock CLI and the client for the CodeFresh CLI are both installed. And now I'm doing the Twistlock image scan here. So I didn't put in a lot of those other details that Matthew mentioned, but we do have those as parameters that you can put in. So you could say, you could pass in anything to the Twistlock CLI, like if you only want to see fixed vulnerabilities and compliance. So if you only want to, for instance, you want to see all the details, or you want to see all the package details, you could pass those in as well as environment variables just by setting a Boolean to true. All right, so here we go. Here's the actual results of the build. So you can see here, my vulnerability threshold check, passed. Everything looks good. Compliance threshold check, I got a failure. So I don't have any information here on what failed. I could have outputted that information, but I also wanted to show you how to get that information later. And I also now have a really nice tight image that's going to tell me, oh, that I did not pass my security scan, and give me a count of all of my different violations and compliance violations for vulnerability and compliance violations. And here's the Twistlock report URL as well. So now that we know that failed, my next step is to actually go ahead and fix it. So here's my master branch. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a Docker run using that same container that was ran locally. And I'm going to...
Dustin, would you mind zooming in on your terminal there a little bit? Just command plus a few times. Thanks.
Is that good enough, Dan?
Maybe two more.
Two more. Okay, great. All right. Let me go ahead and clear my screen again so everyone can see it at the top. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and run that same Docker image locally now that I'm using inside of my CI. So here I just have to set the image to scan. I could have probably set this as a build variable, but I'm just going to edit it inline here. So I'm going to scan Docker Twist CLI, and I'm going to do it against my master because I'm actually running against master here, and I want to get more information out of master. So I've already built this master container, but I'm going to show you later as I build and scan. So here, I set it to get details, and I have details of all the different compliance violations, and I'm not seeing the compliance violation I was expecting to see in there. Git pull. Okay, add group, already up to date. Let me do a Docker build real quick. Supply master. Make sure I'm built from the most recent master. All right, so that should be the correct master. Now let me go ahead and run that again. I tried to save some time and not have to build that locally for everybody. All right, so here I built it from the master branch. I just did a pull against, so everything is fresh and up to date. You can see at the very bottom there that I have a high compliance issue. That now it's telling me the image should be created with a user, which is great information. You know, if somebody does happen to break into one of your containers, they have root access into that container, they can do a lot of different malicious things inside that container. So now I'm going to go ahead and fix it. So first thing I'm going to do is check out a new branch. All right. And then I already have the code. I kind of cheated here. I have the code available to me as part of what I'm doing for my demo purposes. All right, I'm going to go ahead and add that code in here. Great. So now I've added that. Everything looks good. So I'm adding a new user. Twistlock. I'm giving it access to the Docker group because I do need access to Docker. And now I'm going to go ahead and build this. And I'm going to update this to be my branch name. So what I'm showing you here is that, you know, your intended development workflow. If this Docker image was your Docker image that you're creating and your developers had to work to fix a compliance or vulnerability violation inside of your application, their workflow would look very similar to this. And then now I'm just going to run this, and then I'm going to do another scan of it and just confirm that it did indeed fix that compliance violation. And of course, this is going to take just a few seconds longer than normal because I added that into the same run command as the original run command. So it had to pull down all my Alpine packages and reinstall my NPM and pip install. All right, so I have that built now. Now I'm going to go ahead and run a scan against that. All right. Now let's take a look and confirm this has been fixed or not. All right, I no longer see it. It looks like it has been fixed. So I'm going to go ahead and commit this. All right, and then I'm going to go ahead and push that up. Pushing that up to my GitHub repository. All right, now I'm going to go back to Codefresh and see how things are going. All right, okay, my new build started. Great, everything's up and running. Looks like it's pending. It's now initializing the process to start everything. And I'm going to go ahead and go into the logs here. So you can see how quickly that feedback loop allowed me to just iterate and fix that vulnerability very quickly. I'm sorry, that compliance violation very quickly, but there are also some other vulnerabilities that I could have fixed as well. So you see here, it gave me vulnerability information. It tells me, oh, the status of this was fixed here. So you could do a very similar process as I just showed with these vulnerabilities as well. But I'm only set to block on critical vulnerabilities, not on high vulnerabilities. I'm gonna go ahead and shrink all these down. Now you can see that even Codefresh at this point has now built my Docker image faster than I built it locally. It's going to be done here in probably about half that time.
Yeah, one thing I want to point out is Dustin's leveraged, you know, our threshold for failing that's part of the Twistlock scan. So you still get alerts and visibility into all the vulnerabilities, but it's only going to fail the build if you did critical. We have also at Twistlock taken the all the compliance checks that are from the Center for Internet Security. They do not actually rate severity of those. So our Twistlock Labs team went through those 300 compliance checks and gave them a severity level. So that way you can focus on the most critical compliance issues first and work off that debt before, and maybe even ignore some of the lower ones that have less risk.
Exactly. And also, you know, if you wanted all that information to be put into your logs, there is, you know, there's a list of all the different options that are available to you for this integration. And you could print out the entire list of all your packages, all your vulnerability information, regardless of whether or not you set a threshold, if you want that information available for you here. You know, the CI user, it is kind of good to have the details in there. I just didn't put it in there, but it's definitely a good default to set so you don't have to run it locally to find out what's going on. The reason why I like to run it locally is I want to confirm it's running locally. All right, so it looks like, oh, sorry. I have to make a change to my pipeline now. Let's go ahead and set this up. Run. CLI master. All right, so let's go ahead and save that. And let's try to build that branch again. All right, and this second build's gonna happen a lot quicker than that first build did. Because it's gonna pull down my cached image that's already available through me through my integrated Docker registry.
Yeah, I like the vulnerabilities which are already in bit. So you can fix how many vulnerabilities you are going to pass in, which is not supposed to fail. So we are excited as Steelcase to implement this and fail our builds when it crosses a threshold.
Yeah, it gives you a pretty simple way to start enforcing security policies without getting into the more advanced features of Twistlock. But I highly encourage you do get into the advanced features of Twistlock, because that's where you're gonna get those settings that both come down into your CI system, as well as get pushed into your deployment time images and being able to block those. So you can see here, I passed both my vulnerability and my compliance thresholds. Everything's passed here. I can go back now, and I can take a look at my images. And I have this image here. Oh, everything passed. Security scan is good. That compliance count is gone from this menu here. And also back on this screen, I can take a look at my branches and take a look at the commits against this branch. And you can see here, I have a passing build. So we have build success passed. So now if I wanted to, I didn't add the extra steps of pushing to a Docker registry or deploying to Kubernetes. But at this point, if that build step passes, it can continue on and continue with the push to your Docker registry and the deployment to your Kubernetes or running your Helm chart installation. And that concludes the demo.
Thank you, Dustin. I'll go ahead and take back the screen sharing from you here.
And then here's just a quick recap of what we did during the demo. So, you know, Docker image containing Twistlock CLI, Codefresh CLI, and a Python scripting to tie the two together. It runs locally and on Codefresh. Locally, you access just the Twist CLI command line, so Twistlock command line interface from that Docker image. And you can, the CI system, as it picks it up, that Python scripting is going to add the Docker image metadata to your Docker image and annotate that with the counts for compliance and vulnerabilities. It's going to set a new Boolean to tell you whether or not security scan passed or failed and give you a Twistlock report URL. And then take that and determine the build success failure based on the exit code of the Twistlock scan, which, you know, can be determined by your thresholds that are set up or by your policy set up over in Twistlock, and pass that back to the version control system so that you have that information back to the user right inside of like a pull request or inside their commit. And there's the URL for the Docker Twist CLI. All right, that's all I have, Taryn.
Great, thank you, Dustin. So thank you to Dustin, to Matthew, and to Varun for joining us today. We still have a couple questions, and if you have any more questions that you would like to add, please add them to the bottom of your screen. There's a Q&A box, and our VP of Marketing at CodeFresh will facilitate those questions in just a moment. I just want to remind everybody that we do have a blog post out right now that details some of this integration and some of what we talked about today, and that can be found at codefresh.io/blog. Also, you can go to sign up for a free trial at twistlock.com. So make sure you can do that and set up a free demo with CodeFresh. You can schedule a one-on-one right on our website at codefresh.io. So with that, let's go ahead and get some of your questions and I will open this up to Dan.
Thanks, Taryn. Great presentation, fellas, all around, tons of information. One of the top questions was, am I going to be able to look at this later? Because it was a lot of information to review. I want to look at the slides. I want to look at the blog post. I want to review the video. Taryn, you can answer that question.
Yes, this video is being recorded, and we will send this out to everybody who registered.
Thank you. And then Matthew, this question is for you. What is the vulnerability database like that Twistlock is using?
Yeah, so we have our own proprietary data and data research team, although we do pull vulnerability data from 30 different sources, including the National Vulnerability Database, Red Hat, Ubuntu, all of the vendors. Specific data on vulnerabilities we have feeds for. We also pull in malware from Proofpoint as one of our commercial feeds and from Exodus Security. So yeah, so we're pulling data from over 30 sources. Some of it is paid feeds. What's really unique about our database though is that the platform is going to determine the best source of vulnerability data for a particular component and CVE. And by doing that, that's how we eliminate those false positives. And when you use our product, you are connected live to our data source. So as new vulnerabilities come in, and they come in on a daily basis, they average about 7 new vulnerabilities a day, your on-site database gets updated daily with that information. So Twistlock as a solution, we feel very strongly that we have the most accurate, most complete, and most up-to-date data in the industry.
So another kind of follow-on question to that is, where do you see most vulnerabilities being introduced? Is it they're being added in by an engineer, they're writing new code? Is it that we're discovering old vulnerabilities? Perhaps that are in production. Where do you see kind of the most common vector?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I've been in this for 8 years, definitely qualified to answer that question. So what we're seeing most of the vulnerabilities actually coming, unfortunately, from open source software. So open source teams, a lot of them are creating base images based on open source OSs. I see the most coming actually at the OS layer, something like Debian, Ubuntu, even Red Hat. These vendors are doing their best under limited budget. They tend to only fix the medium high vulnerabilities. I think the second highest is probably from the JavaScript and Java ecosystem. So you're going to see vulnerabilities in JavaScript and jar files. Quite often, they show up in applications like Jenkins, JBoss, etc. But then the components in those open source apps become available to commercial companies like Steelcase, and they put them in their application. So the breach, for example, in the Equifax breach, was a Struts 2 Java component jar file. That allowed someone to run any script they wanted on your server. And that's how they were able to steal 150 million plus people's data. Yeah. So I would say number one, OS, number two, Java, JavaScript, and mostly from open source software. But those components get used in commercial software. Everybody is utilizing this ecosystem.
Yeah, and it seems like typically, almost in every case, when someone's hacked, it's a known vulnerability. It's very rare, it sounds like, that it's really a 0 day. Someone just discovered this just on your system. It seems that it's usually known and indexed.
It is, Dan, and that's a really good point. And the reason for that, unfortunately, is the known vulnerabilities are published at different sites. The MVDB is the most popular, well-known one. And when that vulnerability is published, then the hackers and would-be attackers, they monitor those sites. They reverse engineer attacks based on the known vulnerability. So to me, you know, a lot of companies are spending tons of effort in trying to make sure their custom source code doesn't have vulnerabilities, but the greatest risk is really on the components, the libraries, the base images, because the known vulnerabilities are open to everyone. They research those vulnerabilities and they launch attacks. And quite easily, you know, Struts is used in almost every website out there in the world. Mm-hmm. So if they attack a known vulnerability, they have a huge, you know, basic potential attack surface. Many, many companies using these common components. So it'd be kind of foolish to try to find custom vulnerabilities when there's so many known ones.
Gotcha. Now, thank you, Matt. Varun, there's another question for you. In your sort of continuous delivery pipeline that you and your team are delivering using Codefresh, using Twistlock, what are sort of the most critical components in that process that you would encourage others to make sure that they adopt?
I would say is start from the base image. So no matter what base image you use or no matter what packages you pull in, you know, they might be third party dependence packages which you pull in, which the packages you pull in from. So I would say start from the base image and make sure you are looking at the builds every day, and just fix them. You don't have to fix them all at once. It's going to be big mess, but it should be easier work on securing your application, doing a simple fix, going through the simple fix or going the critical fix at first and then reducing your to the minor fixes. But it should be done if you want your application to be safe, and it's not a good thing to relay just on network and node restrictions.
Gotcha. Great. Thank you, Varun. Then Dustin, this is another question about the, you showed a screen at one point that showed the vulnerabilities and things. And there was a question of, could you maybe open that again and talk about kind of what the possibilities are here? Here we're showing some of the vulnerabilities, but maybe you could speak to kind of how this is used in a typical engineering organization like Varun's or other Codefresh customers.
All right, and I imagine they're talking about this images screen. So right here, what it is that, you know, your logs are so busy. If you've ever done it in any CI system, Jenkins, whatever, there's a lot of different logs that are happening all the time. We group those up, that's great. But even then, they're still hard to kind of parse through and figure out whether or not things were successful. So this is like an annotations area that's surfacing the Docker metadata that's related to this Docker image. So what you're gonna see here is all the annotations that are done by your different build steps. So this one's just, you know, your security scan information that I've put in for this particular build step. But there's many more build steps that you're going to have available to you that you might want to add to this annotations area. You might want to add information from your project management source, like maybe a Jira ticket for your feature that's on here. You might want to add information on whether or not unit testing was successful, whether or not integration testing was successful, maybe the coverage report from your unit testing. You might want to introduce load testing or any type of performance testing. And you might want to give information on the latency or link to a performance testing report like at BlazeMeter. You know, all that information can be gathered up here for all your users to see in this image level. And then if you actually connect up to a Kubernetes cluster, let me show you something really cool here. So if you deploy, you know, from your Codefresh system into your Kubernetes cluster, you're going to see I have a Kubernetes cluster selected here. And inside of here, I can see that here's all my services that are running. And all these images that are loaded up are going to link right back to that image metadata screen, which is going to give you more information on, you know, here you can see the unit testing, unit coverage, performance report, timeline of events, just like my other screen. You can get back to the logs, the Docker file, And of course, I didn't show this, but since this was driven from version control system commit, you can get back to the commit in that version control system too. So it's a really great one-stop shop to just get an over high-level overview of everything that happened during your CI process back in one space, including your deployment process. It can get all the way back from your Kubernetes clusters running for your upper tiers.
Yeah, and it seems like what I've seen people doing with this is it basically becomes the end-to-end view of everything that's happening with their development process from commit to deploy. So that's why the twist lock comes in. That's why the Jira ticket comes in. That's why all these different reports come in. And this goes a little bit to something that you touched on, Matt, which was sort of that a lot of the underlying sort of code, the stuff that's actually the baseline of the Docker image, the software that you're relying on, is where a lot of the vulnerabilities end up creeping up. So this becomes pretty critical if you're going to be kind of container first, container native. It means that one of the advantages is that you can actually scan the entire stack at once, basically the entire underlying software, not just maybe the code that you're making. So I think that's pretty cool. Let's see. So Dustin, one other question for you, which was, everything you showed me, will this work behind the firewall? Can it go on-prem? Is TwistLock capable of doing that? Is CodeFresh capable of doing that? Can you work with behind the firewall, maybe, you know, Bitbucket server, those kinds of things?
Yes, absolutely. So we have several different offerings available. I'm showing you our SaaS offering currently, but you've seen that Kubernetes cluster. That's not part of our SaaS system. That's actually part of a hybrid solution. So you can bring your own Kubernetes clusters, or you can bring your own Docker nodes to run on top of your infrastructure. So just, you know, set up a Docker node or Kubernetes cluster, connect it into CodeFresh. Then you can take all your CI operations on premise. And in a lot of cases, TwistLock, from what I've seen, and maybe Matthew, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is actually deployed as an on-premise solution and normally behind the firewall, because it might not be the best idea to, you know, work with that or expose that publicly.
Yeah, absolutely. The TwistLock solution is deployed as Docker containers. It is an on-premise deployment. The only thing off-premise is the data service to get the daily updates for vulnerabilities. And even that, we even support an air gap environment for that, where you can manually update. So the actual vulnerability database is deployed in the product on-premise. Only the updates come in from our data service. And of course, that's through a TLS connection, so a secure socket connection.
Gotcha. All right, great. So yes, so as you're running your CI builds and you're doing all this work, and you're, you know, integrating with your TwistLock on-premise installation, you're integrating with your other on-premise services, we can do that completely on your firewall behind your system. And if you want to, you can take CodeFresh and run it on-premise, and then you don't even have that abstraction layer of, you know, running a hybrid solution, but you have either option available to you.
Gotcha, great. This is another question for Matt, and I think we'll probably close after one or two more questions. Matt, there was a question that, you know, obviously TwistLock has this security scanning service and basically we'll check all your underlying code. Are there other security offerings that you think are important for you to pair with that maybe TwistLock likes to see, other security tools or other scanning services, either for threat detection or things like that? Have you seen it paired with anything else?
Yes, absolutely. There are a few. We're fairly comprehensive, but one of the places we don't do is scanning custom source code, static source code analysis. So that would be very much a complementary technology. The other thing we do is we have the ability for all of our scan reports and all of our runtime and firewall audit violations. We have a solution where you can push that out to the syslog. And then once you do that, then you can leverage other technologies like Datadog, Sumo, et cetera, where you can monitor that system log and run forensics and analysis and do alerts. Absolutely. So advanced logging platforms and static source code analysis are kind of two areas that would be very much complementary to the TwistLock platform.
Mm. Gotcha. This question is for Varun, and I'm not sure if you can pass on it if you'd like. The question is, were there any sort of wow moments as you're introducing security scanning into your process things that surprised you or really made you glad you went down this road or things like that?
There are a couple of moments. Number one would be just buckle up for increasing your time, your build time. So it's gonna increase your build time as per if you need scanning on every branch. So that may be a downtime, but apart from that, it actually helped us on get controlling our scan, our vulnerabilities and our third-party packages and making sure everything is secure while we are doing other important stuff when developers are working or new microservices are being onboarded. So that's a good rest of a good night's sleep, but just the minor one is just increasing build time. That would be my complaint. But apart from that, we could DevOps team in our office can take rest because of this integration of security CAD scope.
Yeah, I'd like to add to that too and say, you know, part of that kind of keeping it, you know, minimal and thinking about how you're going to do this, you can actually set up Codefresh and those build steps to run on conditionals. So that build step could actually say, one, be driven by the branch that it's pushed to, and two, be driven by the commit message. So if you wanted to run a Twistlock scan on demand in your CI system but didn't want to run it on every feature build, you could actually pass in the word like Twistlock in your commit message, and then it would pick that up and execute that Twistlock scan. And same with your other long-running scans. So if you didn't want to run your performance scan every time, but you had a certain feature branch that you wanted opened, and you said, okay, I want to run performance scanning or security scanning, you can do that just by passing in the commit message or pushing it up to one of the upper branches, one of your mainline branches, like if you're using GitFlow, your develop branch, for instance.
I agree. Yeah, that's what we are doing right now. We just put in logical conditions of Codefresh steps, and we only are scanning when people need it, and if it's a PR, if it's merging to master or stable branch. So that kind of decreased all the time, overall time, and that unifies all the security scanning in our organization right now.
Great.
Hey Varun, this is Matthew. I do have a quick question for you. I'm just kind of curious, the reception of the products now that you've implemented the Twistlock and Codefresh solution, how are your development teams, security people, what's their kind of view of the product? Is feedback from them, kind of curious from your teams?
Our security team loves it. So whenever we go into production, we have a detailed report, and we take few of these vulnerabilities to fix in every sprint. So we have our tracking on what exactly are vulnerabilities and what we are going to take in this user story in this sprint, and what we are going to fix it in next week. So we have a detailed report on how many vulnerabilities we fixed it, and we haven't seen any new things popped up after we introduced it into our pipeline, but we are still working on getting it low, as much low as we can, and then block the builds on any new discovered policies.
Any feedback from your developers? One of the things is, you know, my passion in life is DevSecOps and breaking down barriers between security and development operations, to me, is a critical piece of this solution. By providing developers with this information early, so they can basically choose good components, good base images, and not have to do a lot of rework. Just wondering if there's feedback from your development teams.
The one thing I can specify is our security patch deployment to production has drastically reduced. So we are not doing any deployments for security patch deployments. So that kind of makes everyone happy. But on the other side, since we are doing it, since we are not blocking anything, developers are good. But once we start blocking, I'm pretty sure developers would be resistant to that. So that's why we are taking in and killing more vulnerabilities before we introduce a block. But as of now, it's an alert. So they are working on it, and there is always some resistance from the developers to work more on fixing the vulnerabilities. But apart from that, since it's a continuous feedback, the work is distributed over the time and should be easier as it you see it when the first time it pops up, or you can just rectify it as soon as you discover it. But in other case, if you if it's some other way, if it's not integrated in the CI tool, and you discover all of a sudden there are 20 critical and 10 high, that's not going to make anyone happy. That's going to block a development, and it's going to block the development lifecycle for another 2 weeks for everyone to jump on it and fix it. But since we have it automated and with the continuous feedback, it's minor work. It's a chore for every sprint, but it doesn't get more into blocking everyone or blocking the main story and working just on the things, which is a mountaintop high.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Well, great discussion. So unfortunately we are at time, so we're gonna end it here. If you do have additional questions, anybody has additional questions, I'd encourage you to reach out to Twistlock or CodeFresh. Happy to Dustin, and we'll probably sit down with you on the CodeFresh side and walk you through some of the other capabilities and things you can do, answer any other questions. But with that, I think we'll end it. We'll kill the live stream on Facebook, and then follow-ups will be in the blog post, right, Taryn?
Sounds good. Have a great day, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.